Good morning, everyone. I am Kritika Monga from the Marketing Department of Elsevier India. Today, me and my colleague Deepti will moderate the entire session. We would like to welcome you all for joining us today. Before moving forward, I would like to lay down some rules for smooth execution of this webinar. You all will be on mute throughout the entire session. You are requested to post your questions in the Q&A tab seen at the bottom of your screen. If you are logged in from your mobiles, you can see the tab at the top of your screen. All your questions and queries will be addressed by the panel at the end of the session. Also, participants will get certificates, but they will be provided to only those who will attend all the three-day sessions. So please remember to register for the tomorrow and day after tomorrow's sessions if you need the certificate for that. Now I will hand it over to Deepti for introducing the speakers of the day. Deepti, over to you.
Thanks, Kritika, and good morning, everyone. A very warm welcome to all of you to this webinar. And on part of Elsevier, myself, Deepti, I'm working as a content strategist at Elsevier for the nursing book section. I welcome you all to this webinar along with the Indian Association of Neonatal Nurses, some strong neonatal nurses who have we have amongst us, who will be delivering you and discussing various aspects of neonatal care, which will be something which will be evidence-based neonatal care. So before I go forward in introducing our speakers, I would request my colleague and friend, Ms. Parvinder Kaur, to take over the session for the inaugural and welcome our dignitaries. Parvinder, over to you.
Thank you, Ms. Deepti. A very blissful morning to one and all. It gives me an immense pleasure to extend to you a very warm welcome on the behalf of Indian Association of Neonatal Nurses that has clubbed us all together on this platform to celebrate National Newborn Week 2020. I am filled with pride, and it is extremely delightful to have a galaxy of eminent experts filled with passion of neonatal care and such enthusiastic delegates across the country with us today. I wholeheartedly welcome you all. We are illuminated by the presence of Madam Dr. Manju Vatsa, former President, Indian Association of Neonatal Nurses, an idol of knowledge and wisdom and an inspiration to all of us. Dr. Manju Vatsa is former Principal of College of Nursing, All India Institute of Medical Sciences, AIIMS, New Delhi, and is currently working as Director, National Reference Simulation Center and Associate Dean Research at SGT University, Gurugram, Haryana. Madam has experience of nearly 45 years in nursing education and research. Madam is a recipient of President of India's Silver as well as Gold medals from Delhi University and an award for the best research in MPhil nursing. Madam is an active member of various national and international organizations and has more than 80 publications and 300 citations. I request Dr. Manju Vatsa ma'am to please address the gathering and present a brief overview of IANN.
Thank you very much, Ms. Parvinder, for that introduction. A very good morning to all. Dr. Jyoti Sirin, President of the IANN, all neonatal nursing experts, resource persons, representatives of the Elsevier, and participants. I'm delighted to be here and extend my greetings to all of you on the occasion of inauguration of the Newborn Week celebrations of IANN. As you know, the theme of Newborn Week this year from the Ministry of Health was ensuring quality, equity, and dignity of newborn care at every health facility everywhere. In view of this, the theme which was chosen for IANN program is ameliorate neonatal outcomes, enhancing evidence-based neonatal care. The 2018 global report on neonatal mortality, Every Child Alive by UNICEF, has found that in India, number of newborn deaths was one of the highest in the world. With the birth of 25 million children each year, accounts for nearly one-fifth of the world's annual childbirths, every minute, one of those babies dies. Nearly 3.5 million babies in India are born too early, and 7 million babies are born with birth defects. Current neonatal mortality rate of our country stands at 23 per 1,000 infants. Though infant mortality has declined considerably, the number of newborns dying each year still remains unacceptably high. India has made considerable progress in reduction of neonatal mortality from its share of the global burden, coming down from one third in 1990 to below a quarter of a global burden of neonatal deaths today. The SDG target which India has for neonatal mortality rate is to achieve a single digit mortality by 2030. It is also important to know that 40% of neonatal deaths happen during labor or the first 24 hours and are due to easily preventable causes such as prematurity, 35%, neonatal infections, sepsis, pneumonia, diarrhea account for 33%, and birth asphyxia, 20%. In addition, 9% is due to congenital malformations. All these conditions can be easily managed by simple, cost-effective, essential newborn care interventions, such as protecting a premature or low birth weight baby, providing warmth, Gangaru mother care, early and exclusive breastfeeding, hygiene and asepsis, involving mothers in the care of newborn, and clinical monitoring before, during, and immediately after birth to identify those babies who are at risk and to make appropriate efforts. In the effort to achieve the SDG target, the Government of India has accorded the highest priority to improving newborn health under National Health Mission, and it has come out with special interventions under RMNCH+A and India Newborn Action Plan to improve newborn survival. These include promotion of institutional deliveries with free entitlements under the Janani Shishu Suraksha Karyakram, providing immediate care for newborns in the newborn care corners at each delivery room, newborn stabilization units at each first referral units, caring for newborns that have serious conditions in special care newborn units at the district hospitals, and fourthly, community-based, home-based care through series of home visits by ASHAs to educate mothers on breastfeeding, the importance of keeping babies warm, and also identify sick newborns and refer them to special care newborn units. Linkages for referrals at appropriate levels of care are being developed. Facility-based newborn care through provision of essential newborn care to all babies at the time of delivery in institutions and treatment of sick, low birth weight, and premature babies at various levels of facilities right from the moment of birth through the neonatal period is a significant step towards neonatal survival. Recently, two training modules were released last week on the occasion of Newborn Week celebrations by the Ministry of Health and Family Welfare on Newborn Stabilization Unit and Navjat Shishu Suraksha Karyakram for upskilling the health workers associated with newborn care. Nurses are the backbone of neonatal care at each level of care, from home to the level 3 tertiary care and ICUs. Empowering the nurses with the knowledge and skills in current evidence-based interventions in neonatal care and quality initiatives can go a long way in reducing the NMR and achieving the SDG target of single digit. The Indian Association of Neonatal Nurses envisioned the dream of establishing a professional organization dedicated to the survival and care of newborns across India through knowledge and skill updates, a tool that would mold and guide the future generations of enlightened nurses for gaining clinical and academic excellence in newborn nursing. It was conceived as a sister organization of the National Neonatology Forum in September 2007 during the International Conference on Neonatal Nurses, which was held at New Delhi. Since the launch of the association, it was registered under the Societies Act in 2008. And I'm proud to say that today we have been growing continuously and consistently and today we are having nearly 1400 members. The aims and objectives of the association are to advance the knowledge and skills, foster excellence, promote scholarship and research, develop and promote standards in the practice of neonatal nursing, to promote the development of neonatal nursing as a specialty, to influence the policy and programs of the country to attain the highest level of health for all neonates and mothers, to foster fraternal feelings and bonding among nurses looking after neonates and mothers within the country, and to collaborate with existing national and international organizations that share similar beliefs and values. Since the inception, in our effort to create a pool of master trainers, we have organized several master trainers training programs in essential newborn care, neonatal resuscitation program trainers courses, facility-based newborn care, and quality improvement. We have been actively involved in organizing events during the breastfeeding and newborn weeks. We have organized 8 annual conferences, and the 9th annual conference is scheduled to be held in Kolkata in the coming year. There has been a tremendous advancement in the field of neonatal nursing education in terms of training with online and digital platforms and quality initiatives in the past few years. And IANN members have played a major role in this. Neonatal nurses are at the forefront of all initiatives being taken for improving the quality of neonatal care services and training and empowerment strategies. There's an increasing need and recognition of neonatal nursing as a specialty. As you're aware that the Indian Nursing Council had launched a post-basic diploma in neonatal nursing. However, as we found that not many takers were there for this program, so recently IANN has modified that program, converted it into a residency-based program, and forwarded it to the Indian Nursing Council. This program is now been approved and it is awaiting a gazette notification. We hope that after the launch of this program, there will be a good response and we'll be able to produce many neonatal nursing specialists available to man the SNCUs and the NICUs in the country. IANN is consistently working towards developing standards and competencies for training of neonatal nurses for pre-service and in-service education, advocacy for starting a nurse practitioner program in neonatal nursing, creation of a cadre of neonatal nurses in the country, and to create positions for specially trained neonatal nurses in all government and private hospitals which have neonatal units. In order to promote research in neonatal nursing, we have been giving awards for 2 best young researchers during our annual conferences. In addition to these, we are also working towards establishing performance standards for neonatal nurses at various levels of care and defining the scope of neonatal nursing practice. We also plan to collate, compile, and recommend a universal package for training in neonatal nursing using newer technologies. I hope in the coming years, our association will emerge as a prominent leader in shaping the future of neonatal nursing in this country. So I invite all of you to be a partner in this exciting journey. As the founder president of IANN, I would like to extend my gratitude and thanks to all the role players that have made it possible for our dream to become a reality, especially the National Neonatology Forum, UNICEF, WHO, and the Indian Nursing Council. UNICEF and Indian Nursing Council have been providing financial and technical support for all our activities. I thank Dr. Jyoti Sareen, Dean of the Faculty of Nursing at MNU Bulbana and the current president of the IANN, for taking up the challenge during this pandemic and successfully organizing this 2-day event on the occasion of Newborn Week celebrations. I also thank the executive members of the association and all neonatal nursing experts for actively supporting this initiative of the association. I also thank Elsevier for the support provided to conduct this activity. I'm delighted at the good response from the neonatal nurses across the country, and I have been informed that nearly 1,700 nurses have registered for this event. This is really a remarkable accomplishment. In line with the theme, ameliorate neonatal outcomes, enhancing evidence-based neonatal care, we have chosen the topics of this two-day event. Dr. Jyoti Siren will elaborate on the details of the program. Our aim is to update the neonatal nurses in evidence-based strategies in improving newborn care and to offer the opportunity to deliver quality nursing care and initiate interventions to optimize neonatal outcomes. I request all the registered participants to remain active and have fruitful interactions, learn the current strategies that can effectively be used on a daily basis in your day-to-day practice and teaching for the benefit of newborns all over India. To all of you, thank you for joining. Welcome and enjoy the deliberations. Thank you.
Thank you, ma'am, for your words of wisdom and your influential message. We feel honored to have with us Dr. Jyoti Siren, Madam, President, Indian Association of Neonatal Nurses, a lady with distinct vision and fountainhead of illuminating ideas. Dr. Jyoti Siren is working as Dean Faculty of Nursing, Director Principal at MM College of Nursing, Maharishi Markandeshwar, Deemed to be University, Mulana Ambala. Madam has 35 years of teaching experience of undergraduate, postgraduate, and PhD nursing program. Madam is certified trainer of NRP, Essential Newborn Care, and Virtual Capacity Building Program for Midwifery Faculty. Madam is recipient of Indian Silver and Gold medals for academic excellence. She is editor of textbooks, Fundamental of Nursing, and contributor for Nursing Research and Biostatistics. Madam has significant number of publications in national and international index journals. I take this opportunity to request Dr. Mrs. Jyoti Siren, ma'am, to present an overview of this webinar series. Over to you, ma'am.
Thank you, Parvinder. And I'm very glad to be there with all of you on this morning. Thank you, Dr. Manju Vatsa, Founder President of Indian Association of Neonatal Nurses, to address the candidates. And we are honored to have you at this platform. And actually, I don't have much thing to say because I endorse all the statements what has been conveyed to us by Dr. Manju Vatsa. So my views are also the same. So without taking much time, I think, Parvinder, we can move ahead with the program.
Yes, ma'am.
Thank you.
Thank you, ma'am. Thank you for your visionary words. I once again welcome you all to this event of Newborn Week Celebration 2020. Hope these 3 days of journey with us will be fruitful and yield positive results. Thank you so much, everyone. Over to you, ma'am Dipti.
Thank you so much, Madam Vatsa and Madam Siren, and thank you, Parvinder, for having a great introduction of our eminent speakers. Not delaying too much, and I'm happy to see a response of more than almost 1K students and faculty who have joined us for this session. I would like to take the opportunity to say that babies are the most precious gifts on earth. The first touch of a newborn is one of the most precious moments in the life of parents. The moment they are born, it brings thrill and smile to our face, which never fades away. And we as neonatal nurses must be proud of having this opportunity to take care of this population. Healthy children build healthy nation, as they are the future of any country. Keeping this thought in mind, I would like to introduce all our speakers on behalf of Elsevier and IANN to all of you. The first speaker for the day would be Madam Poonam Joshi, who is working as an Associate Professor, College of Nursing, All India Institute of Medical Science, New Delhi. Madam has a great professional experience with over 63 publications to her credit. She is a master trainer for many programs like the ENBC, IMNCI, the GFATM program, and so on. Madam is also an author for the Pediatric Nursing Textbook and has many awards to her credit. The topic for today that ma'am will be discussing with us will be physiology, routine care, and the initial steps of resuscitation as part of the neonatal resuscitation program. Welcome, ma'am. The second speaker for the day would be Madam Malar Kodi, who is working as an associate assistant professor, College of Nursing, AIIMS Rishikesh. Madam is an alumni of Rajiv Gandhi University, a PhD scholar from AIIMS Rishikesh, and over 13 years of experience in her professional life. Madam is an active member of the Sigma Theta Tau International, TNAI, SOMI, IANN, NRSI, and many such organizations and associations. Madam also has a credit of over 35 research papers to her kitty. Madam will be discussing about positive pressure ventilation with us today. I welcome you, ma'am. The third speaker for the day will be Madam Gitanjali Kalyan, who is working as a tutor, National Institute of Nursing Education, PGIMER, Chandigarh, College of Nursing. She is an alumni of AIIMS, New Delhi, and a PhD scholar. Madam is a member of many professional organizations like the IANN, NNF, TNAI, CNRS, NTAI, GFNPSS, and IAMBSS. She has over 13 years of professional experience and is currently serving as a Zonal Coordinator IANN, Executive Board Member of IANN and NNF. She has over 50 research articles to her credit, and Madam will be discussing about chest compression in the neonates with us today. Welcome, ma'am. The next speaker for the day is Madam Lewis Murray. She is working as an Associate Professor at College of Nursing, AIIMS, New Delhi. Madam is an alumni of MGR University and a lifetime member of many professional associations. She is a co-inventor of the MAMPOD, a garment for providing kangaroo mother care. This is one of a remarkable thing I saw in her credentials, which I felt that, you know, we all should be knowing about it. This is a remarkable thing to have you. And she's a national mentor for the Lakshya, a labor room quality improvement initiative by the Government of India. She is also the quality improvement coach for supporting improvement efforts for MNCH in the WHO CRO region. And Madam will be talking with us regarding endotracheal intubation in the neonates. Welcome, ma'am. The last and final speaker for today will be Dr. Shashikant Dheer, one gentleman among all the ladies here today for the session. Sir is working as an associate professor and unit head at Guru Gobind Singh Medical College, Faridkot. Sir did his MD from SMS Jaipur from 2005-08 and his IAP fellowship in neonatology from GMCH Chandigarh in 2011. His DM neonatology from PGI Chandigarh in 2017 to 2020, and author of many books, resource person for various conferences and seminars, several awards to his credit, as you can see. And sir will also be discussing about chest compressions with us. I welcome you, sir, on board, and we are happy to have you here. Over to you, Madam Gitanjali. I will stop sharing my screen and we can start the session with you. Madam Poonam, can you start with the session, please?
Hello. Good morning, everyone. Hello. Am I audible?
Yes, hello. Yes, very much audible. Yes.
Good morning. At the outset, I would like to congratulate the INN and the Elsevier for taking this initiative to arrange 3-day online web series on neonatal care. I'm sharing my screen.
It's visible here.
Yeah.
Yeah. I have been given the responsibility to elaborate on the overview of neonatal resuscitation program and also to talk on routine care and initial steps of resuscitation. Fortunately, we have just received new resuscitation guidelines, which also I'll be elaborating on, and I will also try to touch upon how to take care of a newborn during the COVID-19 pandemic. We are thankful to the facility-based newborn care resource management program, which has been developed by the Ministry of Health and Family Welfare and the NNF. And most of our material has been taken from this resource material. Now, at the end of this webinar, our friends will be able to appreciate the changes in the physiology that occurs when a baby is born. They will also be able to appreciate the risk factors, which could be antenatal or intrapartum risk factors that can help them in predicting which baby might require resuscitation. Then we are going to learn the entire algorithm, which describes the sequence of steps to follow during resuscitation. The most important thing is the preparation in terms of equipment and personnel, so as to promote survival of every newborn. And then finally, I'll be discussing on the routine care and the initial steps. We all desire to have a lustily crying baby and an active newborn baby in the labor room. This is considered to be a matter of great delight for every mother, every obstetrician, nurse, and a pediatrician who is attending the delivery. My slide is not moving. Okay, so here I would like to re-emphasize that ventilation is considered to be the most important and effective action in neonatal resuscitation program. We need to understand the importance of learning neonatal resuscitation program. This slide is showing a pie diagram, which is describing the statistical data related to the neonatal morbidity and mortality. You can see here, asphyxia is considered to be the third most important cause of neonatal mortality and morbidity after infections and the prematurity. The infections as a whole include sepsis, pneumonia, tetanus, diarrhea, and prematurity, followed by asphyxia. So asphyxia is something which is preventable by anticipating, by making all the necessary arrangements required for the delivery of baby, we can to great extent prevent asphyxia. Now, this another slide will help you in understanding again the birth asphyxia to be considered as the most important aspect of neonatal morbidity and mortality. This is a slide being taken from one of the studies where we had 258 newborns, and approximately 20.9% of the babies were affected with birth asphyxia. So you can say out of 258, it comes to 54. So 54 babies, they had developed birth asphyxia, and which contributed to neonatal deaths. Now, further to emphasize on, we have learned that birth asphyxia is approximately contributing 23% to neonatal deaths every year. But by making appropriate efforts, we can improve the outcome in thousands of the newborn babies. There are approximately 10% of all the babies who require resuscitation. Let us assume that in our labor room, suppose 100 deliveries are taking place, 90 of them are going to have a very smooth transition from intrauterine life to extrauterine life. It's only the 10 babies who would be requiring resuscitation. And further, I would like to say that these 10% also majority would be requiring minimal resuscitation efforts in terms of stimulation, in terms of providing initial steps and ventilation. It's only 1% of the babies who require extensive resuscitative measures in terms of chest compression, endotracheal intubation, and administration of medication. Here we have a TABC of resuscitation, which can be expanded as ensuring the thermoneutral environment in the labor room and an ICU that is between 26 to 28 degrees Celsius temperature, ensuring airway by positioning and clearing the airway. The newer guideline says that we do not go for routine suctioning. It is to be decided by the experts whether it is required or not. So newer guidelines emphasize on doing no routine suctioning. Then we stimulate the baby so as to help her to take her first breath, followed by assessing every baby for heart rate and color so as to find out whether baby is having adequate circulation or not. And very few, rarely less than 1%, as I said, are going to require drugs. Now let us understand the meaning of asphyxia. Asphyxia is a Greek word which means there is lack of oxygen supply in the respired air, which is leading to actual cessation of apparent life. And as the previous slide has already explained, that 23% of the newborns, they are likely to have asphyxia. So we have already understood the meaning of asphyxia is failure to initiate breathing. Now, what is resuscitation? Resuscitation is to arouse again. So by skillful, by timely resuscitative measures, we can ensure that the asphyxiated baby is not developing any kind of brain damage. We are protecting her from getting crippled and minimizing the subsequent neonatal morbidity. Here we have a triangle which is describing the steps that are usually followed while resuscitation. So you can see here the inverted triangle, which is broad at the base, and it says that almost every baby is to be dried thoroughly, positioned. We have to clear the airway. We have to stimulate baby if required. Most of the baby, 90% of the babies, they breathe on their own. But as you can see this triangle, it is getting tapered, and lesser babies would be requiring supplemental oxygen followed by assisted ventilation, intubation, providing chest compression, and very few would be there who would be requiring medication. So if we are able to effectively ventilate a baby immediately after birth, we might not require the extensive resuscitative measures such as chest compression, intubation, and administration of medication. Now, friends, again, here I would like you to revise the anatomy related to fetal circulation. We all know that baby is dependent on mother for her existence in utero. So it is the placenta which is supplying oxygen, enriched blood to the baby. And this blood via the umbilical vein reaches to the right side of the heart, and from the right ventricle, it goes to the here you can see through the ductus arteriosus, the blood is getting diverted to the aorta. As in utero, baby's lungs are not functional. The alveoli, they are already filled with fluid. So the blood, which is reaching to the right side of the heart, tends to take the least resistive pathway and gets diverted to the aorta. And there you can see baby is likely to get this supply in the systemic circulation. Now, here you can see the condition of the lungs of baby before birth. That is, in utero, what is the status? Here you can see the alveoli, they are filled with fluid, as lungs are not involved in the process of gas exchange. And the vessels here you can see, they all are constricted because of the absence of oxygen. So the important two features you have to appreciate here. Number one, the vessels, they are constricted, and the alveoli are filled with fluid. Now, what changes we observe at the time or immediately after birth? Baby starts her own breath. As she is initiating her breath, you can see the fluid present in the alveoli gets replaced with the air. So here you can see the first breath is allowing, is dispersing, removing fluid, and the subsequent breaths keep the alveoli completely free of fluid as this fluid gets absorbed by the lymphatics. And finally, you can see the alveoli is completely replaced with air in place of fluid. So these are the changes taking place at the time of birth. And as I said, 90% of the babies have smooth transition from intrauterine life to extrauterine life. So what is happening when baby has started initiating her own breaths and you have clamped and cut the umbilical cord, you will find there is rise in systemic vascular resistance and fall in the pulmonary vascular resistance. So it is the oxygen enriched blood now reaches from the left side of the heart, start pumping to the aorta, and this ductus arteriosus, which was in utero functional, becomes non-functional immediately after birth. And it is the high concentration of oxygen which makes this ductus arteriosus getting functionally closed immediately after birth, and anatomically it may take few days to get closed. So these are the changes observed at the time of birth. Now there can be some problems during this transition phase. The breathing may not be forceful, or sometimes you may find baby has fetal distress which makes her pass meconium, and this meconium may be aspirated and may block the airway of the baby. There can be excessive blood loss leading to poor cardiac contractility and development of systemic hypotension. And hypoxia, as baby is failing to initiate her own breath, her breaths are not forceful. Hypoxia is further exacerbating the constriction of pulmonary vasculature, leading to the development of PPHN, that is persistent pulmonary hypertension. Now, how does baby respond to this kind of abnormal transition? Baby can respond to this abnormal transition in number of ways, such as can elicit poor muscle tone, can have poor breathing efforts, will be manifested in the form of bradycardia, low blood pressure, fast breathing rate, followed by initially fast breathing, followed by apnea and development of cyanosis. Now, in this slide, you can appreciate the changes that are taking place when baby is failing to initiate her own breath. You can see here, there are two types of apnea being described. One is primary apnea and second is secondary apnea. Primary apnea usually takes place in utero. By the time baby reaches to your hands in the delivery room, you will find baby is already in a state of secondary apnea. And this graphical representation will help you to differentiate primary apnea from secondary apnea. In primary apnea, you find only the change in the heart rate while the blood pressure is maintained, but in secondary apnea you find drop in both heart rate as well as the blood pressure. So here the take home message is, if you have a baby who is in the state of apnea, assume this baby to be in a stage of secondary apnea and just stimulate once or twice. We'll be discussing how to stimulate the baby, but this stimulation is to be done just once or twice. And if not responding, you can switch over to bag and mask ventilation. Now, next, this is the algorithm which we are going to discuss in depth today. And here I would like to spend another 5 minutes to describe this algorithm. And my co-speakers are also going to discuss this algorithm in small pieces. So here I would like to just highlight the important points in this algorithm. One is the periodic assessment. Every 30 seconds, you just evaluate the condition of the baby and you decide what is to be done next. You take the step and then again evaluate. So after every 30 seconds, you can say there is an evaluation being done in terms of assessment of heart rate and respiration. So this is one important point you have to remember. Number two is, what are we observing immediately at the time of birth? At the time of birth, there is one person to note the time, and you as a receiver going to receive the baby in a dry, warm linen. And the first and the most important question, this is the only important question which you are going to ask, is baby breathing or crying? So this is the only question we ask at the time of receiving the baby. So this is second important point I would like to emphasize on. And then you can see here two important heart rates. That is heart rate less than 100 and another heart rate is less than 60. So whenever baby is having heart rate less than 100, that's the time to initiate positive pressure ventilation. So remember, throughout this training program, you will be made familiarized with these two heart rates. One is less than 100 and another one is less than 60. So less than 100 is the time to initiate positive pressure ventilation. And if you find heart rate is less than 60, that is the time to initiate chest compression in a coordinated manner along with positive pressure ventilation. Then you can see here, there are two types of care being prescribed, that is observational care and a post-resuscitation care. Any baby who has received resuscitation for more than 1 minute should go for post-resuscitation care in either in SNCU, or if baby is in the tertiary level care facility, baby should be observed in NICU. While if baby has just received resuscitation for less than 1 minute, you can provide observational care to the baby, just keeping her next to the mother. So by keeping her next to the mother, you can observe her. So these are some of the important points which I wanted to highlight. And then you can see here the role of the pulse oximeter and the ECG monitoring. The newer guideline says that you have to have pulse oximeter as well as ECG leads attached to the baby so as to monitor the progress made by the baby during the resuscitation. Now, here, lastly, you can see the endotracheal intubation can be done whenever you are anticipating prolonged resuscitation, or if you find baby is born with the congenital diaphragmatic hernia, or if baby has not responded to your effective ventilation. So despite 30 seconds of effective positive pressure ventilation, if baby is not responding, then that is the time you can think about endotracheal intubation. Now, many students, they usually ask this question, should we go for Apgar scoring at the time of resuscitation? So here the answer is, one should not pay attention to Apgar. Apgar scoring is recommended for all babies who are normal and who are crying immediately after birth. And Apgar scoring is done at 1 minute after birth. While resuscitation is to be initiated, the moment you find baby is not breathing, you think about initiating resuscitation before you are scoring, you are assigning a score. So score is usually assigned at 1 minute, while resuscitation efforts are initiated just after the birth when you see baby is not breathing. And the two important signs for evaluation are respiration and heart rate. And the third one is the color. But the most important ones are the respiration and heart rate. Now, next comes the preparation for resuscitation. We have to prepare in terms of preparing the resuscitation area, that is maintaining the temperature between 26 to 28 degrees Celsius. We have to have personnel available. Two trained personnel should be there to attend one delivery. And we have to have
properly disinfected sterilized equipments available to be used for the resuscitation. So here we have a small video which is emphasizing on preparation for resuscitation. So we'll just quickly see this video and then we'll go ahead.
Madam Poonam, I think the yes. video is not visible. You can just exit your screen first, your slideshow, so that the video is, you know, visible.
Okay.
Yeah.
Or can we run it at the end so as to...
Yes, we can do that. You may continue with the session.
My God, what is happening? Is the screen visible? I think we can run these videos at the end. Hello?
Yes. Please continue.
Okay. So we'll just see what are the equipments we require for successful resuscitation. We have to have a radiant warmer, which is switched on 30 minutes prior to the delivery, a set of two blankets, a self-inflating or flow-inflating bag, and wherever TP's resuscitator is available, that can also be used in place of this self-inflating bag. A suction catheter of appropriate size, 12 or 14 French. A mechanical suction source, stethoscope, shoulder roll, mask, oxygen delivery system, laryngoscope blades, endotracheal tubes in different sizes varying from 2.5 to 3.5 mm. Meconium aspirator in case if you find baby has aspirated the meconium. A watch or a clock is needed with the secondhand facility so as to closely monitor the time. IV fluids, warm IV fluids, and the umbilical catheter for cannulation. So here, this is how we proceed when the baby is born. We ask immediately after birth, is baby breathing or crying? Gasping is a significant problem. We have to understand that and is to be considered similar to apnea and should be managed on the tune of apnea. If baby is crying, in that case, we need to provide routine care, which includes providing warmth by keeping the baby on the mother's chest and abdomen. These days, we have a practice of delivering all crying babies directly on the mother's abdomen. Clearing the airway is to be done by turning the head of the baby to one side and all the visible secretions are to be wiped. Remember, there is no routine suctioning required. Baby needs to be thoroughly dried. We have to give proper attention to the head of the baby, head being the largest, having the largest surface area. And removing the wet linen from the site and stimulating baby to breathe and reposition if required. So this is how we provide routine care to our baby. And then there can be another possibility that baby is not crying. In that situation, we go for initial steps. Now the initial steps in the newer guidelines have been reframed as initial actions, which aim at maintaining the thermoneutral environment as well as the airway management. So the steps remain the same. That is, you are going to provide warmth to the baby, but now, since this baby is not breathing, not crying, you are immediately going to clamp and cut the cord and take this baby under the radiant warmer. So here the source of warmth for the baby is going to be the radiant warmer. You are going to open the airway and provide the initial steps of resuscitation by placing a shoulder roll under the shoulders of the baby. Resuscitate when meconium is present and provide free flow oxygen when needed. So the steps remain the same. That is, you are providing warmth, you are drying the baby, you are positioning the baby, you are clearing the secretions. No routine suctioning is needed. And you are going to do further, the extensive suctioning is required if you find baby is non-vigorous and there is meconium present in the airway. And these babies, in addition, can be provided free flow oxygen. Remember, there are certain target saturations we have. The target saturations, if you have a baby at 1 minute time, don't expect that baby will have 90% saturation. The saturation may be around 60 to 65%. And gradually we find improvement in the saturation of a baby over 5 to 10 minutes time. So here, the most important steps include are drying, stimulating the baby, and repositioning the baby. So this is how we provide shoulder roll to the baby. This application of shoulder roll helps in giving slightly extended position to the baby, which is called giving sniffing position to the baby. So clearing the airway, the copious secretions can be allowed to drain by gravity by turning face to one side. If you are doing suctioning, the suction should be done in a very gentle manner, keeping the pressure less than 100 mm of mercury. Mouth followed by nose, and stimulation of posterior pharynx to be avoided, as it can cause vagal stimulation and can lead to the development of bradycardia. So remember, the newer guidelines, as per the newer guidelines, no routine suctioning is needed. It is only to be done if you find, as an expert, that baby is non-vigorous and baby has respirated meconium. Premature babies are more vulnerable to cold and stress. So for them, what do? We provide them a polythene sheet. So we immediately receive the baby in a polythene sheet, and this baby continue to remain in the polythene sheet till the time she is shifted to an ICU. The reason being, they have a large body surface area, they have a very thin skin, and there is paucity of subcutaneous fat, and they have decreased metabolic response. So all babies who are born before 35 weeks of gestation can be received in a polythene sheet. Clearing the airway depends upon the presence of meconium and the baby's level of activity. So a vigorous baby is a one who has strong respiratory efforts, good muscle tone, and heart rate more than 100 beats per minute. On the other hand, the non-vigorous baby would be a limp baby who is having poor respiratory efforts, having poor muscle tone, and heart rate less than 100 per minute. So this is how deep tracheal suctioning is done, but again, it is only recommended by the expert when the baby is non-vigorous and there is presence of meconium in the airway. You can see direct visualization of glottis is done using the laryngoscope, and suctioning is done from the trachea. So the current guidelines are not based on the meconium consistency, rather they are based on the response of the baby, whether the baby is vigorous or non-vigorous. The techniques which we were using in the past, like squeezing the chest, occluding the airway, should not be done. What is recommended is gentle stimulation, either by flicking the soles of the baby or by providing back massage to the baby. And at the end of 30 seconds, this entire act should get over within 30 seconds time. And at the end of 30 seconds, you have to check the heart rate and respiration. Now, heart rate, how do we check? We check for 6 seconds and multiply it by 10 so as to get the actual heart rate of the baby. Let's take an example. If in 6 seconds time, you got 10 beats, you have felt 10 beats, then you can multiply it by 10 and the heart rate of the baby becomes 100. After you have completed your initial steps, you can provide free flow oxygen to the baby. So free flow oxygen is indicated for all those babies who have received the initial steps and who are having breathing with efforts, who are having heart rate more than 100 beats per minute, but they also have central cyanosis. So any baby who is having, who is not breathing well, but is taking a lot of efforts to breathe, that baby should receive free flow oxygen. So these are the various methods we use for providing free flow oxygen. You can have a free flow anesthesia bag, you can have a mask being used, or you can even make use of your cupped hand to provide free flow oxygen. Even T-piece resuscitator is being used, but we are not using self-inflating bags for providing free flow oxygen, as this bag only works when it is squeezed. So the newer guidelines with regard to COVID-19 pandemic, the knowledge is still evolving and the day by day we are becoming wiser. So you may find further changes in the guidelines, but as it is there till today, you can see that all pregnant women with suspected or confirmed COVID-19 should be considered as vulnerable group of patients. And there are a lot of perinatal period which poses unique challenges, and the care of the mother and baby died is to be done in a special manner so that the transmission of infection is prevented, the infection is timely diagnosed, and we are providing appropriate care to them during labor, resuscitation, and then in the postnatal period. So the resuscitation guidelines remains the same. We should follow the standard guidelines even for the COVID-19 affected mother who is delivering her baby. The additional recommendations are, we encourage every mother to observe hand hygiene and making use of triple layer mask for the mother. The other recommendations are, preferably the delivery should be taken in a separate room. If it is not feasible, then you can have the resuscitation warmer at least 2 meters away, separated physically from the mother's delivery area. The recommendations for neonatal resuscitation are, you require 2 number of personnel, trained personnel who are donned in full set of PPE, and the facility for donning should be available at the entry, where the entry point, and the doffing facility should be available at the exit point. The recommendations go in a usual manner, delayed cord clamping for all term babies, and for all late preterm babies, followed by skin-to-skin contact. No bathing is recommended for the obvious reasons. And during resuscitation, one should avoid giving medications through the endotracheal route because of the possibility of aerosol generation. And in the newer guidelines also, it has been recommended that the umbilical route should be preferred over the endotracheal route because it is found to be more efficacious. In case of COVID-19, we are not recommending to go for endotracheal route because of the possibility of aerosol generation. Inline suctioning is recommended, and indications for intubation remain the same. Any baby who is expected to have prolonged ventilation, who is not responding to effective bag and mask ventilation, can be considered for intubation. Along with this, we have to observe all the infection control guidelines in terms of observing hand hygiene, proper donning and doffing, observing disinfection and sterilization, and proper biomedical waste management. So as a conclusion, the neonatal resuscitation depends upon the teamwork. The success depends upon the teamwork. Teamwork includes that is anticipating the need for resuscitation, briefing the team members, communicating to them, giving them role assignment, and then preparing before resuscitation. Structured checklist should be there so as to ensure that we have all the equipments and supplies available required at the time of resuscitation. And all these are to be properly documented. And most of the babies, so the take home message is most of the babies, they respond to the initial steps. So with this, I stop here and I hand over to Mrs. Malar Kodi, who is going to deliberate on positive pressure ventilation. Thank you.
Madam Poonam, can you start sharing your screen?
Yes, yeah. I will. How to exit?
Ma'am, we need to click on stop screen share.
I can't see. It is just a new share. Okay, I got it.
Thank you, ma'am.
Is my screen is visible?
Not yet. Have you clicked on the share screen icon?
Yes.
Ma'am, it's loading. I think there's an internet lag. Can you just click it again? Do that again. Exit and do that again.
Now, could you be able to see?
No, not yet, ma'am. Okay. We need to exit the screen share mode. Yeah, now try it again.
Yeah. Do you want me to project the slide?
No, I'll try once because I have changes. It's coming like your screen sharing is fast. I don't know why. Shall I try it once again?
Yeah.
Sure, ma'am. You can try again.
Is that visible?
Not
yet.
Can you double click on that once?
Again, I'm sorry.
If there is a lag, should we go to the next speaker and come back to you, ma'am?
Sure, ma'am. Ma'am, can you put your slides if you have?
Yes, I can do that.
Yeah.
Just give me a moment.
I think these all topics are put in a sequence, so we cannot jump from one to another.
Yes, ma'am.
It has to be Malars only, but somebody else can help her to share her screen and present her PPTs.
Can you see my screen, all of you?
Yeah, I can.
Yeah.
So I can move further if you are ready with it.
Sure.
Please let me.
Sure.
Deepthi, you can go ahead. Deepthi, you can project the screen.
Okay. So I think now it's visible. Please go ahead.
Good afternoon, everyone. Thank you, Madam Poonam, for elaborating the initial steps of resuscitation. So I'll go ahead with positive pressure ventilation. After providing initial steps for 30 seconds, still the baby is not able to. Ma'am, next slide. Next.
Yeah.
In this lesson, So after providing 30 seconds, still the baby is not able to maintain the heart rate more than 100 beats per minute, still gasping or showing the apneic signs. So we have to move to the providing of positive pressure ventilation by using room air. Next. What is the indication of providing positive pressure ventilation? After the initial step, if the baby is not breathing or heart rate is below 100 and still apneic, gasping, heart rate is less than 100 beats per minute, after free flow oxygen, still we cannot able to achieve the target rate of oxygen saturation. So we have to call immediately for the help if we are alone. And if the baby is not responded to initial step within the first minute after providing oral stimulations, you have to provide positive pressure ventilation. Ma'am, next. See, these are the devices we use for positive pressure ventilation. Flow inflating bags, self-inflating bags. So mainly in India, we use the self-inflating bags, which is available everywhere in labor rooms. So the capacity of the bag is 240 to 500 ml. For newborn baby, we mainly use 240 ml bag. And TPS resuscitator, if pre-flow oxygen is still available, we can use TPS resuscitation. Next. Self-inflating bag, if you can see this, the word itself is self-inflating resuscitation bag. The bag itself will inflate after once you give a pressure, and it will go in back into the normal space. And again, it will take the air from the out room air, and it will give oxygen to the baby. And we have six safety valves in the self-inflating bag. Like especially we have this pressure release pop-up valve. If you give more pressure, more than 30 to 40 mmHg H2O, it will release it and it will provide only the needed pressure to the baby. That's why it's called positive pressure ventilation. Next. So we have pop-up valve, which will mainly help the baby, and it will be set up for 30 to 40 cmH2O. And port to attach to the manometer, and it is having a outlet and inlet that will give oxygen to the baby. Flow inflating bags only will, if you have free flow oxygen, only will compress with a gas source connector, and the bag has to be filled with oxygen and give the pressures. This will only can able to done by the expert, because this needs more skill for that. Here there is no safety valve and no pop-up valve present in flow inflating bags. Next, ma'am. Self-inflating bags have more advantages and disadvantages. Will always refill after being squeezed, even with no compressed gas source. Pressure release valve makes overinflation unless likely. And disadvantages, will inflate even if there is no tight seal. So that, and requires a reservoir to deliver 100% of oxygen. Cannot see used to deliver free flow oxygen reliably, and cannot deliver CPAP, and can deliver only PEEP. And only when the special valve is connected, we can deliver the oxygen. Next. TPS resuscitator, it's a flow controlled pressure limited to ventilator device, and especially it is available in tertiary care level. Advantages, consistent delivery of PIP and PEEP, can be used to provide free flow oxygen. The provider does not get tired while using this TPS resuscitator while ventilating. Disadvantages, needs compressed gas source, required pressure to be set prior to use. Changing inflation pressure during resuscitation, it's more difficult. Take a prolonged inspiratory time. So better we use initial stage, that self-inflatory bags is more better than in this two method, resuscitator. Next. Face mask, it's very important here is correct size of positioning of face mask, selection of face mask, and providing, making a seal in the face mask. So we have, you can see here, we have cushioned rims, like less traumatic. The bag mask itself will have cushioned rims that we can able to provide for the tiny newborns, and it will give better fit. Shape, we have round or anatomical shape, and we have round square shape also. It's, this size should be appropriately fit the baby. So next slide. So here we can see that providing PPV and with appropriate size of mask. How you will identify the mask is appropriate. So it should be rest in chin of the newborn. It should cover the mouth and the nose. It should not, you can see the pictures here, you can appreciate here the correct position. It covers the mouth, nose, and chin, but not the eyes. That will be the correct size. And incorrect is, it should be, it should not be too large. It should not cover the eyes and should not extend over the chin. And again, incorrect is, it should not be too small for the baby. It does not, when it does not cover the nose and the mouth well. So this, the main important is to give a correct size of face mask. It should cover the nose, mouth, and the chin, but not the eyes. Next. So as Madam Poonam already have explained, that preparation of the equipments. So you have to be ready with oxygen tubing and oxygen reservoir. Should adjust the flow of oxygen to 5 to 10 liter per minute, and it should have block outlet or mask by form. And you have to check the equipment, especially the amber bag, the self-inflatory bags. Next, ma'am. There is a two method to check. Ma'am, next picture. Yeah. So you can see here, there is a two method to check. So you, in the palm of your hand, you can put the mask and you can give the pressure. When the pop-up valve is cussing up, that means they're giving a proper pressure to the baby. And when it is there in the flow meter of oxygen, you can check that the pressure is 30 to 40 mmHg. That means the mask and your self-inflating bag is ready to give a ventilation. Next. The free request is for PPV, select appropriate size mask that it should cover the nose, mouth and chin, not the eyes. Be sure there is a clear airway. So already ma'am have explained that you have to clear the airway. Position the baby, the sniffing position you have to provide. Position yourself at the bedside. After selection of your face mask and check, after checking your equipment, you get the clear the airway and position the baby. Next. Yeah, this is the correct position. This is called sniffing position. You have to provide under the shoulder of the baby, a 5 centimeter of cushion or the roll that is called shoulder roll. Then make the baby in a sniffing position. So this, you can see this arrow marks, it should be in this C shape. And incorrect is you should not hyper extend your the baby's neck. So it should not be too much the wide position. It is not. It is too much extended. And incorrect is too much flexion. If you are not provided the shoulder roll, so the child will be going to the flexion position that will not provide proper ventilation to the newborn lungs. And the hyperextension also, if you provide the shoulder roll beneath the shoulder too much, so that will give a hyperextension. So that also it just will not work for the effective ventilation. So this position is very important. Sniffing position, providing 5 centimeter of roll under the shoulder of the newborn. Next, ma'am. After selection of proper mask size, position, suction, then you have to place the mask in a proper level. That is, first you have to put the mask in chin, cup it, and mask in, cover the nose and see whether the baby is able to. We can cover the chin, no, mouth and nose of the baby. And you have to give a tight pressure on the mask so that there should not be leak in the air. So you have to create a E seal, E and C seal on the mask. You have to provide a C seal on the mask and E seal on the chin of the babies. This is a very important position and the proper method to provide PPE. Next, ma'am. Yeah. So how you will position, where the provider has to stand? The provider has to stand head end of the baby or at the side of the baby so that there is room to check the baby every 30 seconds and room to give the baby for umbilical catheterization and provide medication to the baby. And leg end of the baby, if you stand, you cannot able to check the baby and cannot provide access to the umbilical catheterization and cannot able to provide medication. So this position should be avoided so that we can check the baby properly. Next. Yeah. So how will you see the frequency of the ventilation? So now I think you would have understand that the proper position, selection of this mask, how to provide position, that is sniffing position, how to place the mask and where to stand. Now, how you will provide the PPE, that is positive pressure ventilation, should be provided in a proper manner. That is 40 to 60 breaths per minute has to be provided to the baby. So breathe, squeeze, you have to give. When you tell breathe, you have to squeeze the bag. When you tell 2, 3, release it. Then again breathe, 2, 3, release. So you can practice this, breathe, 2, 3, breathe, 2, 3. So squeeze, 2, 3, squeeze, 2, 3. That also can work it. So you have to, that 2, 3 has to be, helps to release the air. So it has start with 25% of oxygen, the pressure in higher in free term, oxygen and increase according to the target saturation. So initial pressure should start with 20 to 20 mm H2 H2O, not more than 40 mm H2O. Next. Yeah. How you will start the procedure after your selection of mask, position of mask, and where you have to stand and position of the baby. So you have to attach ECG electrode if it is available or the pulse oximetry to see whether our PP is getting effective or not. And stand at the head end of the child or at the side of the child. Apply mask covering the chin up to the nose, covering the mouth even. Count the rhythm like breathe, 2, 3, breathe, 2, 3, to maintain the correct rate, that is 40 to 60 per minute. Avoid giving too much pressures because the lungs may become over inflamed and you may get abdominal pressure that the lungs will not be extended more. If the stomach is distended, you have to decompress by putting OG tube and evaluate after every 15 seconds if the HR is less than 100 beats per minute. How you will be ensuring the effective PPV? After providing, taking all effort like selection of mask, putting everything, so you have to ensure whether I am giving effective PPE or not. So how you will be knowing that? Most important sign of is rising heart rate. If you're putting after 30 seconds, if once you check, it should rise and it should not be less than that, less than where you have started. Improvement in oxygen saturation, that's why you have already attached with pulse oximetry. So you can check whether oxygen saturation is getting improved or not. Equal or adequate breath sounds. Bilaterally, whether we get equal or adequate breath sounds or not. Good chest rise. This is very important sign whether are you giving an effective bag and mask ventilation. Each and every time when you cues, you have to check the good chest rise. If there is no chest rise, we will move on to that how you will check. Reassess heart rate every 15 seconds. If increasing, continue PPV for 15 seconds more and you have to reassess it again. So here when you started providing after 30 seconds, you have to give 50 seconds first assessment, after 50 seconds on 30th second, you have to see the second assessment. If not, check for the chest movement and follow the ventilation corrective steps. It is called Mr. SOPA. It is, if no chest rise is come, if you see, you have to see the Mr. SOPA for correcting your position, your size, your pressure, everything. If call out each finding loudly and document each finding. Each step, whenever you do it. Next. Rapid chest rise, you have to see. You have to see improvement in color and tone, audible breath sound, and chest movement. So these are the four important signs for effective way to give PPV. Next, if a baby is not improving, you cannot able to see that there is saturation is not improving, the baby chest rise is not there, the baby heart color is not changed. So you have to seal, maybe the seal is inadequate, maybe the airway is blocked, like your position is wrong, maybe the secretion may be present in the lungs of the baby, small nostrils, mainly in newborn, small nostrils may present it. If you don't give enough pressure, that the baby may not improve it. So you have to check it first 15 seconds, whether this all the things are improving or not. If not improving, this may be the reason that baby is not improving. Next, please. Yeah, if the baby is not improving, we must do some ventilative corrective steps. So that is the corrective step for easy remembrance. So you can keep it Mr. SOFA. M stand for mask adjustment. So the correct position of mask is cover the chin, mouth, and the nose. So again, you check whether you have already sealed the mask properly by covering the chin, nose and mouth? Are you giving a proper pressure by C and V position of your hands? Then R is reposition airway. Whether are you providing sniffing position, whether it the baby is in a flexion or hyperextensive position or not. If it is not there, then please correct to the sniffing position. Yes is stand for suction the mouth, then nose. So if secretion is present, visible secretion if you see, so you do the suction of the mouth, then the nose. O, it's open mouth. So especially we can see that small nostrils, nostrils in the new preterm baby. So because of small nostrils, the ventilation, the air, whatever you are giving, the oxygen may not enter into the baby lungs. So just you can open the mouth, the baby. Slightly we can open the mouth and you can lift the jaw forward. P, pressure increase. So you have to gradually increase the pressure. Next every new few breaths ke liye, you have to increase the more pressure. Then A, airway alternative. If still you cannot able to maintain it, so you can consider ET, endotracheal tube, or LMA for providing pressure, PPV. Next. So after doing a corrective steps, you have to assess whether the alert the team when the chest movement with ventilation is achieved. So once you achieve the chest movement with after corrective steps, so each assisted breath announces that chest is moving now, so that you the other team members knows, or you also will be knowing that yes, the chest is moving for providing effective PPV. For 30 seconds you can give after corrective method. Reassess after 30 seconds if effective PPE is that moves with the chest. If the heart rate is continuously more than 100 and baby started breathing spontaneously, you can stop PPV and baby can move into post-resuscitation care in SNU or NICU. And if the heart rate is less than 100, in spite of all your effect, after 1 minute of effective PPV, so you can go for an alternative method like ET or LMA, or you can go chest compression. The baby is not able to maintain the heart rate more than 100. Next. Yeah, so I have told that you have to assess two times. That is first assessment, the heart rate after 15 seconds of starting PPV. So if the heart rate is increasing, announce that heart rate is increasing, you should continue PPV. Second, heart rate assessment after another 15 seconds. If the heart rate is not increasing after the 15 seconds, or chest is not moving, so you have to announce that heart rate is not increasing, chest is not moving. Then chest is moving. Continue PPV and move to the chest. Second, if the heart rate is not increasing but chest still rising, that means you are providing proper PPV, but you can do for the other another 15 seconds. And second HR after 15 seconds of PPV, if that move chest is moving it. Not increasing, the heart rate is not increasing but chest is also not moving. That means you have to go for a corrective steps of Mr. Sofa, and you have to announce that this is not moving and continue with PPV and check the chest movement. Next. Second assessment, heart rate after 30 seconds of PPV, that the moves chest. So at least the heart rate should be 100 beats per minute. So you have to continue PPV 40 to 60 breaths until the spontaneous effect is taken by the child. If the heart rate is 60 to 99, that means you have to reassess the ventilation. Ventilation corrective steps can be taken. It is less than 60, you have to reassess the ventilation. Ventilative corrective steps if it is needed, you can necessary, you can take and insert an alternative airway, that is ET or LMA. If no improvement, 100% of oxygen, and you have to move with chest compression.
Madam Muller, just would like to remind you that you may have to wind up your session in another 2-3 minutes.
Okay. So when to stop? The heart rate is less. If it is more than 100, if it is improving improving muscle tone, then you can stop it. Next. Yeah. So then we have a small video here. Ma'am, please, can you, for 2 minutes video, can you put this video?
I'll try to do that.
See, you have to put the full screen, or either you have to copy.
Can the other speakers go on mute, please?
हाँ मैंने कर दिया आंसर कर दिया मैं ठीक है हाँ जी नहीं मैम डिजिटल नहीं हो पा रहा है
मैम वॉल्यूम
कैन यू हियर इट
No, Deepthi, you haven't selected the computer audio.
Okay. Just
stop sharing the screen and then you can select the computer audio.
Okay, just give me a second.
Yeah.
I think now you should be able to. I'm just trying.
Yeah, once you click on share screen, you will be able to see a computer's share computer audio button at the bottom.
Here it goes. I think now.
Yes. In this video, we shall learn about the use of a self-inflating bag for delivery of positive pressure ventilation. The self-inflating bag used for newborns usually comes in capacity of 240 ml. The main parts of the self-inflating bag are the reservoir inlet, the oxygen inlet, self-inflating bag, pop-off valve, fish mouth valve, patient outlet. The face mask is attached to the patient outlet and comes in sizes of 00 and 0. The indications to use bag and mask ventilation include apneic or gasping baby or a baby with heart rate less than 100 per minute after the initial steps of resuscitation. Now, to use a self-inflating bag, press the face mask firmly against the palm and squeeze the bag. Feel for the pressure in the hand. Along with this, see the up-down movement of the pop-off valve and the bag should re-inflate immediately after the use. Connect the oxygen tubing to the bag and set the FiO2 on the blender at 30% when you decide to initiate bag and mask ventilation. The bag and mask is now ready for use. Before we start the use of bag and mask, ensure that we stand on the head end or the side of the neonate so that we can appreciate chest rise. Ensure that the baby's head is placed in sniffing position. This can be achieved by placing a shoulder roll underneath. Along with this, ensure that the airway of the baby is cleared of secretions. The mask should snugly cover baby's nose, mouth, and should cover the baby from the bridge of nose to the chin. It is important to achieve a tight seal for effective bag and mask ventilation. Bag and mask ventilation is delivered by squeezing the bag and assessing for effective chest rise. The rate of delivery of ventilation should be 40 to 60 breaths per minute. This can be achieved by doing the ventilation as per the following sequence: squeeze 2-3, squeeze 2-3, and so on. Continue bag and mask ventilation for 30 seconds. Assess for increase in heart rate and look for chest rise. After 5 to 10 inflations, if the heart rate is less than 100 per minute or chest rise is not adequate, perform the following steps. Readjust the mask to ensure tight seal and reposition the baby in sniffing position. If the heart rate is still less than 100 per minute or chest rise is not adequate, then clear any secretions. Ensure that the mouth is open and increase the pressure of the squeeze of the bag. If none of these are effective, consider endotracheal intubation.
I think we can come back to the presentation.
Hi, I'm going to do a little demonstration for you on how to set up the NeoPuff mechanical ventilator on for a neonatal patient. All right. So the first thing we're going to do is we're going to use a blender today because I want to be able to adjust.
Yes, Madam Muller, you can continue. Hello, Madam Muller, can you hear me?
Yes, ma'am. After programming, after seeing this video, I think the participants will be would have understand the positive pressure ventilation, how to provide in the newborn. The take-home message is proper selection. After 30 seconds, initial step, if the baby is still not able to maintain 100 beats per minute, start with PPV. Proper selection of mask is very important. The seal, the pressure should be more than 30 to 40. It should not be less than 20. It should not be less than 40. Proper positioning of mask is very important, covering chin and nose. And standing at the head end, provide sniffing position, clear the airway, and provide effective PPV by seeing the chest rise. Thank you all for patient listening. Thank you so much,
ma'am. And I'm stopping the share. I'll move the session to Madam Gitanjali for her session. I would like to remind all the speakers to keep up to the time because we are at 12:40 right now. So kindly, the remaining three speakers, kindly stick to your time. Thank you. Over to you, Madam Gitanjali.
A very good afternoon, everyone. I hope my slides are visible and I'm audible.
Yes, ma'am.
Yes.
At the outset, I would like to thank organizers for giving me this opportunity. So I would be talking about chest compressions. I just wish to show this slide. This is the source for today's sessions. So the first one is the FPNC NRP module that has been developed by the National Collaborative Centers for FBNC under the aegis of Ministry of Health and Family Welfare. And other side is the update from the American Heart Association. So both the things have been clubbed together, and we have focused more on the algorithm which have been given by the FBNC modules. So all of the speakers have used that, and I would be continuing with the same. So objectives for today's presentation are: at the end of this session, the participants will be able to identify when to start chest compressions, perform chest compressions and coordinate it with positive pressure ventilation, and recognize when to stop chest compressions. So I'm continuing with the algorithm, and you have learned till positive pressure ventilation, and I'll be focusing on the chest compressions. So we learned that despite taking ventilation corrective steps, that is MR-SOPA, even if this heart rate remains less than 60, we would be starting the chest compressions. So this is the indication: heart rate less than 60 beats per minute despite 30 seconds of effective positive pressure ventilation, or if you have considered inserting an alternate airway, even after that the heart rate is less than 60, we would be continuing with the chest compressions. So why to perform chest compressions? So it is very important to understand that due to lack of oxygen, the myocardium is depressed, and due to this the cardiac output is less, and to improve or to supply the oxygen to the vital organs, it is important to perform the chest compressions. So what we do in the chest compression, it is the mechanical pumping of the heart that is required to improve perfusion to the lungs and other vital organs. So it is also referred as external cardiac massage, rhythmic compression of the sternum that compress the heart against the spine. We increase the intrathoracic pressure with this activity, and that help us to increase the circulation to the vital organs. So that's what is being done in the chest compressions. So we have to remember that we have to compress and then we have to release. So compression ensures that the blood from the heart is pumped out and it goes to the vital organs, whereas the release helps us to ensure that the heart is refilled again. So it is important to release. In any case, you forget to release, the heart will be empty and you would be compressing the empty heart and the vital organs will not get any blood supply. So it is important to release, compress and release. Okay, so how many people required? As we have to coordinate both the events, that is the chest compression and positive pressure ventilation, we have to have two people to provide the chest compressions and PPV. And we should remember that the person who is providing the chest compression would take the lead and will announce, and the subsequently the person who is providing positive pressure ventilation will provide the positive pressure ventilation. So we will discuss in the subsequent slides how it will be coordinated. So there are different techniques of providing chest compressions. Basically there are two. One is the thumb technique, which is being shown in the picture. The baby is encircled with the hands, and the thumbs are placed over the sternum to compress. So we use thumb in this technique. That's why it is called as thumb technique. And the other technique is the two finger techniques, where we use our index finger and the middle finger to compress the sternum. Both the techniques have their own advantages and disadvantages. Thumb technique has advantage that it is less tiresome than the two finger technique. It has a better control over the depth of compression, because you would be better able to estimate the compression, that is the 1/3 of the anterior posterior diameter. Now, there are certain disadvantages, like it cannot be used effectively. The infect is big and hands of the operator are small. Access to umbilical cord is more difficult if you're using thumb technique. Pressure on the ribs can cause fractures. So these are some advantages and disadvantages of the thumb technique. Whereas as per the 2020 guidelines by American Heart Association, it has been recommended to preferably use thumb technique whenever it is possible. So it is better to use thumb technique over the two finger technique. So two finger technique has its own advantages, and it is definitely being used in any case we want to have an umbilical access, or it is more convenient if the baby is large and the operator hands are small. Better control over the depth with both the techniques, it's better. But it is much, much better with the thumb technique. So there are certain disadvantages also, like it on the people who are working in the labor room, they should ensure that their nails are cut, and they can use the two finger technique whenever it is needed. So there are certain common things in the two techniques. So most of the common thing is that position of the baby. Firm support.
Madam Gitanjali, your voice is breaking.
Ensure that the baby is off your hand. Okay.
Gitanjali, is it stable now? Yeah, it's stable now. Can you go back again, like from position of the baby?
Okay. From here. So there are certain common things in the two techniques. That is the position of the baby. So you have to ensure that the baby is lying on a firm surface. And moreover, with the help of your hand, you support the baby's back in both the techniques, in the thumb technique as well as in the two finger technique. You would be keeping your hand under the baby when you are using the two finger techniques, and with the help of thumb technique you would be encircling the baby, and automatically your fingers would go back of the baby, and that provides the support to the baby. So in addition to this, you have to ensure that the baby's neck is slightly extended, and my previous speakers have well explained how to extend the neck by keeping a shoulder pad, and ensure that throughout the NRP, the neck is slightly extended. So compressions. So we have to ensure that the compression is always at the same location, at the same depth, and at the same rate. So if there is any problem with any of the three, you would be delivering ineffective chest compressions and the baby's condition would deteriorate. So you have to ensure that you are at the same location. That's why it is always encouraged that you should never lift your hand after compressing. You have to keep it there only, but you have to ensure that you release the pressure so that the hurt is filled again. Okay, so this is the position of the thumb. This is the costal margin. You have to move your fingers from the costal margin, identify the xiphoid process, and then you have to draw a line between the nipples, internipillary line, and in between the two, you have to place your thumb or your finger, whatever the method you have chosen. And as I already said, preferably you should use thumb technique. So you should place your thumb here. So this is the landmark for delivering the chest compressions. I'm repeating again, move through the costal margin, identify the xiphoid process, draw an interlipnary line, and in between the two, you should place the place your thumb. And you should ensure that you should never compress over the sternum, over the xiphoid process, sorry, not over the xiphoid process. Okay, so this is the position again shown in this picture. So this is the correct positioning of the thumb. So you should appreciate that the thumb are placed vertically, not laterally. And the pressure is being delivered vertically to compress the hurt. And in any case, you would deliver the pressure laterally. This is lateral. If you will keep your thumb lateral to the chest, the pressure would be delivered laterally, and it can cause injury to the baby's chest wall and underlying structure. So you have to ensure that you keep your thumb vertically and deliver the pressure vertically, not laterally. Okay, so similarly in two finger technique, two finger tips of the index finger and the middle finger is being placed over the landmark, and you have to position perpendicular to the chest and support the back with your hand. So you have to keep one hand under the baby's back, and you should use the other hand's index finger and middle finger to compress over the sternum. Be cautious of putting pressure of whole of your hand on the chest. So you have to ensure that you do not deliver too much of pressure, but it is adequate and it is continuous when it is required. You should release when it is required. You should compress, but you should not lift your fingers above the landmark. Otherwise, you will face problem. So this is the correct technique which is being shown in the picture, where you are using two fingers and the other hand is under the back of the baby to support the baby's back. So this is incorrect position. If you will keep your fingers like this, you would be delivering the lateral pressure and you would cause injury to the ribs and to the underlying structures. So you should not use your fingers like this, right? So how much pressure is needed? We need to understand that approximately 1/3 of anterior posterior diameter of the chest. So when you will encircle around the baby, you would understand that what is the AP diameter, and about 1/3 of that AP diameter you are going to compress. So one compression is downstroke plus release. Remember to release, but not to lift your hands from the sternum, from the position, from the landmark, right? That is very, very important. Okay. So how much pressure is needed? So 1/3. 1/3 pressure is needed to compress the heart and take out the blood from the heart to the vital organs. Again, I'm emphasizing, do not lift the thumb or finger off the chest position area. Lose control over the depth of compression and may compress the wrong area, and it increases the chances of trauma. So this is the correct method. This is the incorrect method. You are lifting your fingers from the landmark area which you have identified. This is incorrect. So we are not going to remove our fingers from the landmark. So structures that can be damaged if you use wrong technique, that can be the ribs, the liver, and sometimes the xiphoid process, and even the lungs. And sometimes if you compress too much, you can also damage the heart. So important is to coordinate with positive pressure ventilation. One ventilation interposed after every 1/3 compression. So ratio of ventilation is to chest compression is 1:3. So total events we would be conducting, that is 120 events. It includes 30 breaths and 90 compressions. So this is how you're going to coordinate it. 1 and 2 and 3, and is to make you remind that you have to release the pressure. Then 2 again compress, and then again release the pressure by saying and. 1 and 2 and 3 and breathe and. So at the breathe, when you will speak breathe, the person who is providing positive pressure ventilation will provide the positive pressure ventilation. So this was all about the chest compression, which is one of the important steps. And this is a small video which I'm showing.
Please exit your screen first.
Is it not visible?
No, it's not visible. Please exit your screen.
Is it not visible?
No.
It's not visible. Please exit your screen first. Please escape from the slideshow mode. Yeah. And then you can start projecting with your computer audio.
I have escaped.
Okay. Okay.
In this video, we shall learn about chest compression.
No, it's not visible. You have to share again. Once you click on the link and share your screen and add the computer audio.
Okay.
Fine. You have to share the screen.
Is it visible now?
No, you will have to share the screen. Now it's starting. Yeah. Yeah. Right. Correct.
In this video, we shall learn about chest compressions. Chest compressions are indicated if the newborn, after 30 seconds of effective ventilation, has heart rate below what is the site for chest compression. The site for chest compression is 1 centimeter below the internipple line. Let us learn what should be the depth of chest compression. We must ensure that the depth for chest compression is at least 1/3 the AP diameter of the chest. Let us learn what is the ratio of chest compression to ventilation. One compression consists of downward compression plus the release. A ratio of 3 chest compressions to 1 ventilation should be provided continuously for at least 60 seconds. It is desirable that a baby who needs chest compression should be intubated to ensure effective ventilation. All babies on chest compression require 100% oxygen delivery. Once the heart rate rises above 60, the oxygen saturation guides the further oxygen delivery. The best response to chest compression is indicated by rise in heart rate. Let us learn about the technique of chest compression. There are 2 techniques that are used. The two-thumb technique and the two-finger technique. The two-thumb technique is the preferred method for chest compression. Place the thumbs on the sternum with the fingers encircling the chest. Flex the thumb to apply pressure vertically. The thumb technique assures better control of depth and is less tiring. The finger technique involves applying pressure over the same site using the middle and the index finger over the site of compression. One must take care not to leave the fingers in between. Heart rate rises above 60.
Okay. Okay, so we learned that how to perform the chest compression. So it is important that you perform with correct technique, with the correct depth and at correct location. So that's all about the chest compression. So now I invite our next speaker, Mrs. Lewis, to talk about endotracheal intubation. Lewis, ma'am.
Thank you, Kidanjali. And I congratulate the IANN for the celebration of Newborn Week and the organizers of this webinar for including my name to present the next topic, which is endotracheal intubation. So I'm just starting the screen share. Is it visible?
Yes, it's visible and you're audible.
Okay, thank you. So in the next few minutes, we'll see about endotracheal intubation and what is the role of endotracheal intubation in terms of neonatal resuscitation. So my previous speakers have already got the source of this presentation, and this is the same. So if we look at this algorithm, we can see these tiny stars here, and we can see it here also. So these are actually the critical points where ET intubation can be considered. So there is no time frame, like, you know, as soon as the baby is born, you're going to intubate the baby, or it will be done after 2 minutes. So nothing like that is there. The procedure of endotracheal intubation has to be done during those instances, you know, where it is indicated. And according to this algorithm, it is, you know, coming at around 1 minute. So at 1 minute of birth, if you think that the baby is going to need prolonged PPV, okay, that can be one indication of endotracheal intubation. So let's see what in this webinar, what we are going to see. We are going to talk about the indications of ET intubation, how to select and prepare the equipment needed, which is a very vital nursing function, how to use the laryngoscope, and how do we determine that the tube is in trachea when we intubate, and how to use ET tube to suction the trachea, and how to use it to administer PPV. So the indications are, as I have said, if we suspect that there is going to be prolonged positive pressure, ventilation required for this baby. And another indication is when the back end mask is ineffective. That means it is not resulting in adequate chest rise. Then you can think about intubating the baby. And if chest compressions are required, then intubation may facilitate coordination and efficiency of ventilation. Because once you intubate the baby, then you don't need to coordinate it with the chest compressions. So it becomes easy for the providers. Then if a tracheal suction is required, for example, MSAF, or if the baby has diaphragmatic hernia, then we know that back end mask is contraindicated, and thus we will go ahead with intubating the baby. And in case IV route is not established for giving drugs, then for giving drugs also, we can use the ET tube. So what are the prerequisites? It's very important to pre-oxygenate before the intubation, because we don't want the baby to go into hypoxia during the time of intubation. And that's why we need to use positive pressure ventilation with 100% oxygen before we decide to intubate. And always remember that we should not use more than 20 seconds per attempt. And as we know that resuscitation is a team procedure, there should be somebody monitoring the time, so that if the person who is intubating is taking more time and it has crossed more than 20 seconds, then you stop the procedure and oxygenate the baby. And we should not try more than 3 attempts in one go. Then it's important to remember that ventilation is, you know, the heart of neonatal resuscitation, and we should ventilate the baby with back end mask with 100% oxygen in between intubation attempts. Let's look at the equipment required. So we need the laryngoscope and we need the blades. So there are different sizes available. You can use 0 size or 00 size for preterm babies, and or 1 or 2 size for term babies. You need different sizes endotracheal tubes. So depending on the size of the baby, we will be using a particular tube size, which we will see in the next slides. But then we should have different, you know, the sizes of tubes, so that if it is needed, it is available. Stillet is an optional item. We need to CO2 monitor also after placement of the tube in order to ensure whether it is in the trachea. Suction catheter of different sizes should be available. Tape, very important to cut it in the right manner. Scissors, oral airway is needed. Meconium aspirator if needed or if available. Stethoscope. And in order to give positive pressure ventilation and free flow oxygen during the procedure, you can use any of these bags. So it can be an anesthesia bag, which already Dr. Malar has explained, or it can be a self-inflating bag or TPS resuscitator. You need a pulse oximeter along with a prop to monitor the baby during the procedure. And in case of difficult airway, it is good to have a laryngeal mask airway also. So what kind of ET tube are best to use? ET tubes are supplied in sterile packages and should be handled with clean technique. And ET tubes with uniform diameter throughout the length of the tube should be used. So some tubes may be tapered at the end. So that kind of tube should not be used. You should use a tube which has a uniform diameter. Use non-cuffed ET tube for neonatal resuscitation. Most ET tubes made for neonates come with centimeter markings along the tube, and it identifies the distance from the tip of the tube to the lip. So you can see in this picture, you have a tube at the end. If you see it at the tube, then at the distal end of the tube, usually you will see a black marking, which is the vocal cord guide. And this marking has to be at the level of the vocal cords when you insert the tube. So it will ensure that the tube is not actually touching the carina, which is the bifurcation of the trachea. And these are just showing the different tube sizes. So here you can see the different tube sizes for different babies of weight and gestations. So accordingly, you can choose the right size for the baby. So if the baby is weighing less than 1,000 gram, then you can go for a tube size of 2.5. And this baby is likely to be in the gestational age of less than 28 weeks. If the baby is from 1 to 2 kg, then tube size of 3. If baby is from 2 to 3 kg, to tube size of 3.5. And if the baby is more than 3 kg, then you can go for tube size ranging from 3.5 to 4. And as said earlier, we have to have different tube sizes available in the kit. It's important that we have a checklist of the equipment at the resuscitation station, where it, you know, in the labor room or maybe in the NICU, so that it is checked and the equipments are available and it is in working order. It's also important to consider cutting the tube to a shorter length. Some prefer to cut the tube beforehand to about 13 to 15 centimeters to ease handling and lessen the chance of inserting it too far. And you also cut down on the dead space when you cut it. And following insertion of the tube, you can remove the connector and cut the tube diagonally to ease reinsertion of the connector. So in this small picture, you can see that, you know, this tube has been cut, okay, and it can be reconnected to the connector. The suction catheter sizes are also should be available for the procedure, and this can guide you, like if you are using an ET tube size of 2.5, then you should have a catheter size of 5 or 6 available. If it is 3, then 6 to 8. If it is 3.5, then 8. And if it is 4, then 8 to 10 French size. So it's important to have this kind of ready recorders in the place where resuscitation is being done, so that you can go for the correct catheter size according to the appropriate ET tube size. And then again, the distance from the tip of the tube, okay, from the tip to lip distance, which we call it. So we can have a rough guide, like if the baby is weighing around 1 kg, then the depth of insertion. Okay, the centimeter which is visible at the upper lip is 7 centimeters. And if baby is 2 kg, then 8, 3, 9, and 4 kg, then etc. So please remember that babies who are very low birth weight, incredibly low birth weight, less than 750 grams, they may require only around 6 centimeter insertion. And then another useful guide to remember this tip to lip distance is to remember 6 and add weight in kg. So it's like, for example, if the baby is 2 kg, then 6 plus 2 will be 8. So the depth of insertion will be 8 centimeter. Preparation of the laryngoscope and additional supplies. We select the appropriate size plate according to whether the baby is preterm or term. And then we check the plate and turn off the light by clicking the plate in the open position to determine the batteries and bulb are working. Prepare the suction equipment. You can adjust the suction source to around 100 millimeter of mercury by increasing or decreasing the level of suction while occluding the end of the suction tubing so that we ensure that we are not providing too much pressure or too less pressure during the procedure. Connect to 10 French or larger suction catheter to suction secretions from mouth and nose. And smaller size catheters can be used depending on the size of the ET tube once the tube is in place. Then we prepare a device for administering positive pressure, a resuscitation bag and mask or T-piece resuscitator capable of providing 90 to 100% oxygen should be available. That is to ventilate the baby between intubation attempts, unsuccessful intubation, and to ventilate the baby after intubation. Turn on the oxygen. The oxygen tubing should be connected to oxygen source to deliver 100% free flow oxygen at a rate of 5 to 10 liters per minute. Coming to the anatomical landmarks. So there are some landmarks which we have to remember when we do the ET intubation. So you can see this is the epiglottis, which is a leaf-shaped piece of cartilage located behind the tongue at the top of the larynx. So this is the glottis, which is the opening of the voice box or the larynx. And you can see the vocal cord, which is like an inverted V. And the esophagus is just in the front. So we have, we also should know the valvula, which is just behind the epiglottis. It is a pouch formed by the base of the tongue and the epiglottis. And these landmarks are important when we go for ET intubation. To position the neonate, we have to position same as for bag and mask ventilation. We can place a shoulder roll to maintain the baby in sniffing position to align the trachea, and you should be standing at the person who is doing the procedure should be standing at the head end of the baby, and it should have a clear view of the trachea of the baby. Avoid excessive flexion or extension of the neck. And the laryngoscope should always be held in the left hand between thumb and the first 2 or 3 fingers with blade pointing away. And the rest of the fingers can provide stability to the face. In this picture, you can see that how the laryngoscope is being held, all right, in the left hand and using the thumb and 2 or 3 fingers. The steps for the intubation: stabilize the right hand with the head with right hand to maintain sniffing position. Second person may be helpful to stabilize the head, and free flow oxygen to be delivered throughout the procedure. Slide the blade over the right side of the tongue, pushing it to left, and advance the blade until the tip lies in the valvula. Lift the blade slightly to raise the entire blade by pulling up in the direction the handle is pointing to expose the pharyngeal area. So here's another picture where you can see the head is being stabilized and the bag is there, which is providing free flow oxygen during the procedure. And this is the picture showing that when you lift the blade, it has to be the entire the jaw, entire jaw, not this rocking motion, which is an incorrect way of doing, because the blade is compressing on the structures here and it can cause injury to the gums and the lips, and the vision is also blocked by the blade. Visualize the landmarks. If blade is correctly positioned in the valvula, epiglottis should be at the top with glottic opening below the vocal cords, appearing as vertical strips or inverted V, just as we have seen in the picture. Inadequate visualization of vocal cord is most important common reason for unsuccessful intubation and can be improved by suction if there is secretion visible, or applying pressure over the cricoid cartilage. So in this picture, you can see at the base of the neck, another person or the same person can, provide the cricoid pressure, which will help to visualize the glottis. Holding the tube in right hand, introduce it into the right side of the mouth with curve lying in horizontal plane. With keeping glottis in view, insert a tube when cords are apart with vocal cord guide position and the level of the vocal cords. So the important thing to keep in mind is the provider who is doing the intubation should not take off the view of the glottis, and the assistant, whoever is handling the tube, should be able to handle it when the provider who is doing the insertion is ready, and so that the cords are still visible and the placement is done at the right place. Stabilize the tube with one hand and remove laryngoscope with other. With right hand held against face, hold the tube at the lips and or use fingers to hold the tube against baby's heart palate. So this is a very important step, that the tube is held steadily and firmly against the heart palate of the baby so that the position is not changed.
Madam Lewis, I may have to interrupt you. Please try to wind up your session in another 1 or 2 minutes.
All right. So the procedure itself is done, and it's important to remember that it should not take more than 30 seconds. And if the glottis is not visualized within that time, then remove the laryngoscope and oxygenate the baby with bag and mask ventilation. So how do you know that the tube is in trachea? So we should look for improvement in the heart rate and color, and breath sounds should be heard over both lung fields, but decrease or absent over the stomach. No gastric distension with ventilation, and vapor condensing on the inside of the tube during exhalation, and symmetric movement of chest with each breath. And if you have a CO2 detector, then you can also check using that. Positioning the ET tube. Use the tip to lip measurement to estimate the tube has been inserted in correct distance. Listen to the breath sounds on both the axilla and see if it is equal. If it is not, then pull back the tube until the breath sounds are equal. And if it is yes, then we fix carefully the tube in that position. So there can be complications resulting from this procedure, like hypoxia, if you're taking too long to intubate, and incorrect placement of tube. So it's important to pre-oxygenate. Bradycardia and apnea can happen because of hypoxia and due to vagal response from laryngoscope or suction catheter. So it's important again to pre-oxygenate and provide free flow oxygen during the procedure and oxygenate after the procedure. Pneumothorax can result due to overventilation of one lung, so it's important to place the tube carefully and treat the pneumothorax if it is present. Contusions or lacerations of tongue can happen, so it's important to gently do the procedure and prevent rough handling. Perforation of trachea or esophagus can happen if there is too vigorous insertion, so handle the tube gently and place it properly. Obstructed ET tube can result due to kink, so try to suction tube with catheter to clear the obstruction. And there can be even infection also if we are not careful with a procedure. And so it's important to pay careful attention to sterile technique. Now we will play the video on ET intubation. So I'm just going back here. Is it visible?
Yes, it is.
Ensure you have all the equipments ready for intubation. You would need another person to help you for providing the supplies, for assessing the heart rate, and for informing the oxygen saturation. Ensure strict asepsis during the procedure. Stand at the head end of the baby. Hold a laryngoscope in your left hand. Choose an appropriate size blade, size 0 for preterms and size 00 for very preterms. Introduce the laryngoscope blade, pushing the tongue away. Visualize the glottic opening. Clear the secretions as required. Identify the vocal cords and introduce gently the endotracheal tube. Do not force the endotracheal tube in position. If the baby takes a gasp, wait and then reintroduce the tube. Remember, there is no role for providing free flow oxygen during the procedure. Rise in heart rate is the first parameter of improvement. Further, bilateral chest expansion, equal air entry on both sides of the chest, absence of abdominal distension, improvement in color, improvement in tone confirms that the endotracheal tube is in appropriate position. Endotracheal tube must be fixed securely. Cut the endotracheal tube 4 cm, extending beyond the lips to decrease the dead space. Thank you.
Hello.
Yes, ma'am.
Yes. So I think with that, I've come to the end of my session. So take home message is that it's a very important procedure in neonatal resuscitation. And we have to remember the timing that it is done within 20 seconds. And as nurses, we have to give importance to the equipment which are needed, make sure that they are in working order and work as a team. Thank you.
Thank you, Levis. Now I invite Dr. Shashi to start his session on medications. Dr. Shashi, please.
Thank you, Ms. Lewis, for a wonderful session on intubation. Am I audible?
Yes, sir.
Yes, you are audible.
Okay, I'm going to share my screen. Are my screens visible?
Hello? Yes.
Am I audible also?
Yes.
Am I audible also? Okay, yes. Fine. Good afternoon, everyone. So I'm thankful to the organizers for providing me this opportunity to talk on a very important topic of NRP. In next 20 minutes or so, I will be discussing about the medications which are required in neonatal resuscitation protocol. So, as already reiterated by Gitanjali ma'am, the source of my presentation would be from FBNC module as well as American Heart Association guidelines. So, recapitulating in just few seconds, we have already discussed about when to do initial steps, how to decide about positive pressure ventilation, when and how to initiate the chest compressions, and what are the indications, techniques of endotracheal intubation by excellent speakers which have covered these topics in a very lucid manner. So this is the standard algorithm which we follow during the resuscitation protocol. So if you can see, the initial part of this includes the determination of the initial steps. If answer to the certain birth and pre-birth questions are yes, then we do routine care. If answer is no, then we provide the initial steps. So after initial steps, we decide about whether the positive pressure ventilation is required or not. So after positive pressure ventilation, we assess whether the ventilation being provided is adequate or not. Then if it is inadequate, we do ventilation corrective steps as indicated by the mnemonic MR SOPA. And then if still the baby is not improving, what we do is the chest compressions. So after this, I'll be talking about what is in my talk. So if after chest compressions, the baby is still not improving, and then the medications have to be given. So what are the objectives of this talk? In this, we'll be discussing about the which medications to give, when are they to be given, and which route is to be used to deliver the medicines, and how to inject through the UVC, and how to administer the adrenaline via various routes, and if at all the fluids are indicated, when are they indicated, how do we administer them. So the important question comes, why medicines are required? So as already told by the worthy speakers, we know now that only a handful of babies will require the medications. This comes out to be around 1 to 3 babies per 1,000 live neonates. Sometimes it is seen that despite inflation of the lungs by adequate positive pressure ventilation, as well as augmenting the cardiac output by doing effective chest compressions, the babies still do not get improved. The reason for this is that the perfusion to the coronary artery, which supplies the heart, is very less. And as a result, there is contraction of the heart, which is way below the required amount. So it is in these situations that we have to give the drugs such as adrenaline. And sometimes in special situations like anticipated fluid loss from the baby, we have to give the volume expanders also. So when to use the medicines? So in this, three things are important. The first thing is the effective positive pressure ventilation has been established. And this effective means even after MR SOPA. And the second is effective chest compressions have already been given. And the third is that the baby is already receiving 100% oxygen. So as you can see that I have highlighted this word despite. So if despite effective PPV after MR SOPA and administration of effective chest compressions and receiving of 100% oxygen by the baby, so doing all these things for at least 60 seconds, if the heart rate is below 60 beats per minute, then we use medicines such as adrenaline. So what is adrenaline? It is a cardiac stimulant. It increases both the strength as well as the rate of the cardiac contractions. It increases the coronary artery blood flow. At the same time, it also leads to peripheral vasoconstriction. So adrenaline is to be given when the heart rate remains less than 60 beats per minute. Now, mind you, this is important. After 30 seconds of effective positive pressure ventilation initially, followed by another 60 seconds of coordinated chest compressions as well as ventilation. So total duration of the first dose is 90 seconds. So if after 90 seconds of positive pressure ventilation, out of that 60 seconds should be with coordinated chest compression along with ventilation, we give adrenaline. So this is important because it should not be given before adequate ventilation is established, because once the ventilation is established, then only adrenaline will be able to take part of the oxygenation and dilatation of the coronary vessels. And if it is given before the establishing adequate ventilation or chest compression, it will rather increase the workload as well as oxygen consumption of the heart muscles. So in that scenario, without improving oxygenation, this adrenaline may cause myocardial damage instead of benefit. Therefore, both the things, that effective PPV as well as chest compression, should be mandatory. Now, how to prepare and how to give. Available concentration in India is 1:1000 concentration. So we have to dilute it 10 times to make it 1:10,000. So how to dilute it? So we take 1 ml of adrenaline and 9 ml of water or normal saline for injection to mix it. So the dose is 0.1 to 0.3 ml of this reconstituted solution per kg per dose. If we convert it into milligrams, it comes out to be 0.01 to 0.03 milligram per kg. So the preferred route is intravenous. But if IV excess is being obtained as a stopgap arrangement, we can give adrenaline through the endotracheal tube also. So whenever we give IV adrenaline, we follow it by flushing it with normal saline in the volume of 0.5 to 1 ml so that it reaches the heart as soon as it is injected. So once again, I repeat that adrenaline available in market comes in 1:1000 concentration. It has to be added with 9 ml of diluent, that is water or normal saline, to make it 1:10,000 concentration. The IV dose which we give is 1:10,000 concentration. So there are some practice points which are important for adrenaline. Whenever a baby will require resuscitation, it has to be immediate. So daily morning, a fresh adrenaline should be prepared. Even better would be ensuring that the adrenaline is available before the start of every shift, so that when actually we require adrenaline, we do not waste time in preparing as well as arranging ADR. So it's a life and death situation. We cannot afford to waste our time in arranging epinephrine at that point of time. The second important thing is, in which there are chances that we may get wrong, is we have to clearly label that adrenaline we are giving IV or adrenaline we are giving through endotracheal tube. And third is, when we are diluting the adrenaline 1 with 9 ml of diluent, first we fill the diluent and then we fill the ADR so that we avoid the under dilution. If we first fill adrenaline and then we fill NS, the chances are there that more amount of normal saline could be filled in the syringe, and then there is no way we can increase or decrease the dilution. Since it has to be given immediately and as rapidly as possible, and we have to flush with the certain fluids also, therefore we have to ensure that the three-way stopcock, which is already prepared, is to be attached to the umbilical vessel. And it has to be flushed immediately with normal saline in IV route so that it reaches the required place and as soon as possible. When we give through intratracheal route, then we do not flush it, then we follow it with positive pressure ventilation so that it is evenly distributed. So therefore, it is to be given rapidly, as quickly as possible, and with the help of a stopcock, we keep the flush also attached to the second limb of stopcock, and we give as rapidly as possible. So this is the picture of the umbilical cord. As we can see, this is the umbilical cord. We have to give a horizontal nick. We secure a tie around the umbilical cord. It is loose tie. As we can see, there is some space between the umbilical cord and the tie. And we give a horizontal nick. And then we identify the umbilical vessel. I would be showing in the next slide how to identify the umbilical vessels. There was a question also in the question answer session, what is umbilical catheterization? So the process of attaining the umbilical vein access is called as umbilical catheterization, and it is used to provide medication during the resuscitation of the baby. So this is the cross-sectional view of the umbilical cord. There is one vein and two arteries usually. So the umbilical vein is identified by a wide lumen and narrow arterial wall thickness. So we cut the umbilical cord horizontally and we place it just where the blood starts coming back. So we prepare the umbilical venous catheter using ANTT. ANTT is aseptic non-touch technique. We have to ensure that, since it is a central line procedure, and although in our type of delivery, we have to ensure that we follow full aseptic precautions. So umbilical venous catheter is pre-prepared and it is pre-filled with normal saline. We cut the umbilical cord around 1.5 to 2 centimeter from the base. We identify the position of the veins as well as arteries. I've already told we have to identify which one is vein. Then we insert the umbilical catheter until there is a free flow of the blood into that. and then we inject the drug. In the umbilical cord port, we had already attached a three-way stopcock, and on one side we give a bolus followed by a flush of normal saline, which is 0.5 to 1 ml normal saline. After the baby is fully resuscitated, we remove the catheter, and later on, if required, we can put the fresh catheter with full aseptic techniques once again. So coming to second route, although not a preferred one, but as a stopgap arrangement, when umbilical venous line is being secured, we can administer umbilical adrenaline through the endotracheal route also. In this, the dose is 0.5 to 1 ml per kg. Mind you, in IV, it was 0.1 to 0.3. So this is much higher than the IV route. So if we convert into milligrams, it is 0.05 to 0.1 milligram per kg per dose. This is followed by positive pressure ventilation so that the drugs get evenly distributed. So the higher dose is because the bioavailability through this pulmonary route is less as compared to intravenous route. Now, this is the diagrammatic representation of how we can give adrenaline. We can give it by NG tube also, which is cut to the adequate length before the giving of the drug, and we can directly instill also, and followed by positive pressure ventilation. So what is expected response? Once we have given adrenaline, we had given when the heart rate was less than 60. So expected, as already told in the first lecture, the best response to assess the effective resuscitation is increase in the heart rate. So important thing is we assess the heart rate after 60 seconds of giving adrenaline. See, 1 minute of giving adrenaline. So heart rate should increase to more than 60 beats per minute after 1 minute of ADR. If no response is there, we can consider repeating the dose every 3 to 5 minutes. If in the initial period we have given the lower dose, the lowest dose was 0.1 ml per kg. If in the initial period we had given the lowest dose, we can consider increasing the dose to higher dose also. If the initial dose was given through endotracheal route, we can give repeat dose, preferably through the intravenous route also. So still there are chances that there is no response. So the more important factor, if there is no response, is to check that whether the ventilation, the chest compression was effective, whether the baby was intubated or whether the baby was having only positive pressure ventilation by bag and mask, whether our method of delivering the adrenaline to the baby was correct, whether dilution was correct, whether it was flushed, this thing is important. Still, there is no response to the endotracheal epinephrine, then we should also consider the possibility of hypovolemia or presence of severe metabolic acidosis. So summary of adrenaline would be, the concentration is 1 is to 10,000. See, it is important, 1 is to 10,000. It is not 1 is to 1,000. So we have to dilute it. The route is preferred is intravenous. We can also give intraosseous. Endotracheal tube only while the excess is being obtained. We prepare and label both the syringes as separately as epinephrine, adrenaline IV or endotracheal. The dose is 0.1 to 0.3 ml per kg in case of intravenous route. It is 0.5 to 1 ml per kg in case of endotracheal tube. Hence, they have to be labeled separately. It is to be given as quickly as possible because we want the reaction to be instant. And therefore, the chances are there if we do not flush, it can remain in the veins itself. So we immediately flush with 0.5 to 1 ml normal saline, and we do not want to waste the time in removing the syringe and then reattaching the syringe. Therefore, a three-way is important. In case of endotracheal tube, we prefer positive pressure ventilation which distributes directly to the lungs. And if required, we can repeat after every 3 to 5 minutes if heart rate still remains less than 60 beats per minute. So this was about adrenaline. Now 2 or 3 slides more. Now coming to second drug, which is volume expander. So if there is no response to resuscitation after even given adrenaline, there is no increase in heart rate, one. And secondly, if historically we know that there is a history of cord prolapse or umbilical cord bleeding, or there was too tight umbilical cord, or if there was vasoprevia leading to a hemorrhage from the fetal side. So if these factors are present, chances are that a baby may have lost some kind of blood and may be having hypovolemia. So in such babies, if we want to ensure, or if we want to supplement our historical findings with examination, so such babies would be paler, they would be having poor pulses, and these babies would be having delayed CRT. So in such babies, we can give volume expanders. But having said that, important thing is in the babies who are already asphyxiated, the heart is already compromised. So therefore, bombarding such a heart which is already compromised with a bolus may actually be detrimental. Therefore, emergency volume expansion is indicated only if, it's important, only if baby is not responding to the steps of resuscitation one and baby has got signs of shock or there is a significant history of acute blood loss. So only if these two things are present, then we consider the administration of a volume expander. So what are the fluids that we should give? We can give normal saline, RL, or in case of frank bleeding from the baby's side, we can give O negative blood, which has been cross-matched with the mother's blood. What is the amount? We give 10 ml per kg. What is the preferred route? Such large volume cannot be given through any other vein. So we have to ensure that the vein good through umbilical vein only. And we have to give a 30 to 50 ml syringes. And we typically give this within 5 to 10 minutes of time. But if the baby is premature, we have to ensure that we do not give too fast and rapid bolus may also lead to IVH. So coming to last slide.
I just want to give you the time reminder of last.
This is last slide.
Yeah.
So
thanks.
Coming to last slide, if still there is no response, if there's still no response, what are we supposed to do? So we have to ensure that whatever we have done in the resuscitation has been done correctly or not. So first thing is we have to ensure that the chest is moving equally with both breaths, with each breath. If the chest is not moving, that means our positive pressure ventilation is not adequate. Second is, are equal breath sounds present? If the breath sounds are not equal, chances are that baby may be having some pneumothorax or CDH. If the airway device or trachea obstructed by secretions, if there are secretions, that again means the positive pressure ventilation will not be effective. So is 100% oxygen being administered through the device? So this also we can simply see. Is the compression depth adequate? As explained by Gitanjali ma'am very beautifully, that we have to ensure that the 1/3 of the AP diameter on the chest has to be compressed. So we just confirm that we are adequately compressing the chest. And whether the correct dose of epinephrine has been given and through intravenous route. If the lowest dose is given, we can increase the dose also. If earlier it was given by the endotracheal route, we try to ensure that the next dose is given through the intravenous route. And if still everything doesn't work out, we still may think that this baby may be having pneumothorax. So that pneumothorax should be ruled out in such type of cases. So this was all about the medications. If you have the questions, you can ask directly or you can post in question answer tab. And if still time permits, you can later email me also on this email ID. So now I'm stopping my screen sharing and coming back to main session.
Okay, thank you, Dr. Shashi, for a wonderful session. I'll be taking these questions now.
So since
we have finished the session now, I will be taking your questions first, and then I would be taking few questions from the previous speakers also. I request all the participants to kindly see the question answer sessions. Most of the questions have been answered, so I'll be taking up only the questions those are left unanswered. Okay, so I am taking up the last questions from the session the last session. The first question is, what is the difference between adrenaline IV and adrenaline ET? Okay,
it is basically, difference means drug is same. There's no difference in the drug. The only difference is in the dose. As I've already told, IV dose is 0.1 to 0.3 ml per kg. Intratracheal dose is 0.5 to 1 ml per kg. Now, otherwise, drug is same. Dilution is same.
Okay. Thank you. Second question for you is, what is the maximum dose of injection adrenaline?
As I've already told, IV is 0.1 to 0.3 ml per kg per dose. And we can repeat it as indicated by the guidelines. Maximum dose IV is 0.3 ml per kg and ET is 1 ml per kg.
So we can repeat how many doses?
Look, we can repeat after every 3 to 5 minutes as per recent guidelines. If there is no response up to 20 minutes of resuscitation, we can declare the baby and then we can stop resuscitation. So every 5 minutes if we take, then we can give 4 doses. If we take every 3 minutes, we can give 6 doses.
Okay, now I'm going back to the previous speakers. So my next question is for Madam Poonam Joshi. Ma'am, are you there? Poonam, ma'am?
Yes, I'm there.
Can you please repeat the difference between primary and secondary apnea?
Primary apnea is the one which usually occurs in utero. And by the time we have baby in our hands, you will find babies in the secondary apnea. Now, as you can see in the graphical representation, in primary apnea, we find only variation in the heart rate. Heart rate starts dropping, while in secondary apnea, you find both drop in heart rate as well as blood pressure. So the take-home message, again, I would like to reiterate that do not waste your time in providing stimulation to the baby, the tactile stimulation. Just do it once or twice. If baby is not responding, just assume that baby is in the stage of secondary apnea and you can plan further for positive pressure ventilation. I hope I have answered the query.
Yes, ma'am. Thank you so much. Now my question is for Levis, ma'am. Can nursing faculty have rights of ET intubation?
I think it's not about rights. It's about whether you are certified or not. So if you have the skills and you have been certified by, say, the AAP or the NNF, and you are in a situation where there is no one else, maybe no pediatrician, and you are, you know, given the responsibility of doing it in your skill, then go ahead.
Yeah. Thank you, ma'am. Okay, so the next question is for me itself. In two-finger technique, the opposite hand will be under same side of the back or the opposite side. See, it would be difficult for us to keep the hand on the opposite side. So we have to keep it on the same side. Say, for example, if you're standing on the right side of the baby, you would be keeping that side of under the baby. The hand would be on the same side, not the opposite side. And moreover, if you will try to keep it from the opposite side, you will cover the baby's chest. So from the same side, you would be keeping the hand under the back of the baby, right? Okay. So the next question is, I think it is also for Levis, ma'am. As per the guidelines, it's mentioned that no drug through ET tube. Ma'am, you mentioned in indication, use drug through ET tube. Please clear the doubt.
Dr. Shashi has answered. So ET route has to be used only if you are finding it difficult to access IV. So the, the priority is to give through IV. That is the recommended route. But if it is not possible because of some reason, then you can give ET. That's the last option. Thank you.
We have answered all the questions. The questions answers are there at the chat. You can see, and moreover, we will also share all the question answers with the participants, maybe through email, if that's possible. Otherwise, I request all of them, all the participants, to see from the question answer session. Okay. There is one query from some participant. Please provide new guidelines on facility based newborn care. See, these are not new guidelines. These guidelines have been developed in 2014, and you can download from them by typing FBNC neonatal resuscitation guidelines. So you would be able to see. We have tried to update these guidelines with the new 2020 AHA guidelines. So these are the older guidelines. You can download them. I have also downloaded, and still there is problem. You can ask for share. Okay, so that's all about the question answer session. Now I invite Ms. Deepthi to kindly take over. Ms. Deepthi, please.
Madam Geetanjali, thank you, Madam Geetanjali, and all the panelists. I heartily thank all of you for this wonderful and informative session. I'm sure all the students and faculty were able to, you know, take away a lot of knowledge and experience from your live sessions and the demonstrations. Which, I mean, we have utilize to the maximum the online platform for conveying the information as much as possible. And this is to all the participants. Please do not worry about the session recording or your certificates for that matter. We will be sharing the recording of all the 3-day sessions as a link with you in your mail IDs with which you have registered. We will also share the question answers with you from the panelists, which is there. And, you know, it will be, as mentioned in the beginning, please do attend the tomorrow's and day after tomorrow's session so that you receive your certificates for the entire webinar. So thanking all of you once again from Elsevier's side and from IAN, I would request and hoping to see you all tomorrow again for tomorrow's and day after session. Thank you so much. Have a great afternoon. Thank you, everyone.
Deepti, may I just have a word with, may I just?
Yes, please, ma'am.
May I request all the resource persons to switch on their video so that we can have a screenshot, and I request Parvinder to take it so that it can be uploaded on the website. Parvinder?
Yes, ma'am. Sure, I will, ma'am.